Audiobooks presents this unabridged recording of Aussie Angels, Sheila the Heeler, written by Margaret Clark and read by Melissa Eccleston. Be sure to visit our website at www.belinda.com. Details of other available and forthcoming Belinda audiobook releases can be found at the end of this recording. The dedication reads, "To Girlie, the best dog in the world." Chapter 1. Carol was a super happy camel. She was going for a late afternoon run along the beach, and Boris was on her back. She loved him more than anyone else in the world. Her good friend Alice, the Labrador, loped alongside, and Mark ran beside them both, while Eddie the Cocky swooped and circled them with raucous cries. Meg and Mike brought up the rear. Mike carried the fishing rods and bait box, and Meg had the special pump to siphon up some sandworms and a plastic bucket to put them in. Dad had said the mullet were running, and as the Green family loved them, Meg and Mike were hoping to hook some unsuspecting fish. When Meg was little, she'd hated fishing. She said it was cruel and she wouldn't eat fish of any kind, not even fish fingers, when she found out they'd been manufactured from living creatures. But then Dad had explained that the fish didn't have to grab the bait if they didn't want to. No one was forcing them. They chose to do it. Also, the Greens only caught what they needed for food, so none were wasted. And Dad had made a firm rule, no more than 6 fish at any one time.
"But how do the sandworms feel?"
Meg had asked, wincing as she'd wondered how it would be to have a hook stuck into your middle. "They have a different nervous system from ours, and they probably don't feel a thing. And seeing as there are millions of them, I guess their relatives don't mind a few of their population going off to worm heaven as fish food," Dad had said. He'd gone on to explain about food chains and how some creatures provided food for others, and that was the way nature worked. Now Meg didn't feel so bad about catching fish, although she always felt sorry for the smaller ones and threw them back. They all converged on the bank of the river. It was low tide and the water was shallow, but already the tide was about to turn and the fish would swim into the river mouth with the incoming waves. The sea was calm, so there wouldn't be a raging current, and with any luck, the mullet would be hungry and ready for a worm fest.
"Perfect fishing conditions," said Mike confidently as he prepared to cast.
He kept his thumb on the catch. Then, as he flicked the rod, he released it and the line went flying high in an arc over the river mouth. There was a satisfying plop as the sinker hit the water, and Mike wound the reel in just a bit to take up the slack.
"Remember when you were just learning to cast and you tossed the hook, line and sinker up onto the bridge?"
giggled Meg, preparing to bait her hook.
"Yeah, the bus ran over it," Mike grinned. "And I was yelling, 'Look, Dad, I've caught a bus!'
I used to think casting was so hard, and now it seems so easy."
"Practice makes perfect."
Meg flicked her rod over her shoulder and then swished it forward, releasing the catch, and her line zinged through the air. Her sinker plopped neatly into the widest part of the river and sent out ring after ring of ripples.
"Good one," said Mike. "Now we wait." "I'll just take Carol for a bit more exercise," said Boris, who wasn't crazy about fishing.
He thought it was boring to sit on the riverbank and wait for a nibble. He was impatient for action.
"Can I come?"
Mark looked hopeful. He hadn't had a ride on Carol for nearly a week.
"Well,
I'm getting withdrawal symptoms."
Boris grinned at him.
"Withdrawal symptoms?"
"You know, I'm nervy and edgy. I need a camel fix."
"Where did you get this withdrawal symptom thing from?"
asked Meg, as Boris told Carol to kneel.
"From TV. It was a program about drugs and smoking and stuff."
"I'll bet Mum and Dad didn't know you were watching that." Meg looked severe. The problem was that Mark had an erratic concentration span, because he tended to absorb only the bits he wanted to, and often missed the entire point of the important information.
Here he was, raving on about camel withdrawals. Luckily, no adults were hanging around to overhear what he was saying, because if they had been, they might have thought he was talking about withdrawal from camel brand cigarettes. Mark quickly climbed on Carol before Boris decided to change his mind. His hair was sticking up straight off his head as if he'd plugged himself in and turned on the switch, and there was a smudge of what looked suspiciously like egg yolk on his chin.
"Did you wash your face and do your hair this morning?" asked Meg. "Sort of."
"What do you mean, sort of? Either you did or you didn't. And I think..."
"Get a life!"
squawked Eddie, jumping onto Carol's head.
"Move it, hairy legs! Over and out!"
"I think Eddie's telling you to stop asking questions about my personal hygiene,"
said Mark haughtily.
"Where did you learn about personal hygiene?" Meg gaped at him.
"Where do you think?"
"From TV," they all chorused. Mark shrugged. It was no big deal whether his hair got combed or his face got washed. Who was here to see it anyway? Only his brother, sister and Boris, and of course a camel, a dog and a cocky, and they wouldn't care at all if he didn't comb his hair or wash his face for a week.
"Ha!"
said Mark, and Carol got to her feet. He giggled happily. He loved the seesaw action when Carol stood up and the swaying motion as she plodded along the sand. Of course, if she was going at full gallop, that was a different sensation again, sort of like being on a roller coaster out of control. But whatever she did felt fine to him.
"See you later,"
he called, as Meg left Mike to mind her fishing rod and got busy with the pump. They needed more fresh sandworms. Eddie was still perched on Carol's head and saying all sorts of naughty and rude things in her left ear as they rounded the point.
"Look at that!"
cried Mark excitedly, pointing to a little group of people who were wearing old-fashioned clothing and standing in a huddle near the cliff. Boris reined Carol in with a sharp tug, but the group had seen them.
"Are they ghosts?"
asked Mark in an awed whisper.
"I don't know. They look real, but..."
"Should we stay or go?"
Mark bit his lip.
"I reckon they're ghosts from that old shipwreck we found a while ago, because they're standing right on the spot."
There were two men wearing stovepipe hats, long coats and dark trousers. The three women with them were all in long black dresses, with poke bonnets on their heads. And there were two children, a boy and a girl, dressed like the kids Mark and Boris had seen when they went with school to visit Sovereign Hill, a replica of an old gold mining town in Ballarat. Suddenly one of the men started waving his fist at them, and the other pointed at them to go back.
"I'm out of here,"
said Boris, whirling Carol round so fast that Eddie nearly fell off.
"Watch it,"
he called crossly.
"Eat that and die. Over and out."
Boris set Carol at a gallop, and the strange assortment of kids, camel and bird went galumping across the sand back to the beach where Mike and Meg were fishing.
"Ghosts!"
bellowed Mark as Boris pulled Carol up with a spray of sand.
"There's ghosts round there. We saw them."
"What?"
Mike and Meg stared at him with their mouths open.
"Come and see, quick!"
"Roosts!"
squawked Eddie.
"Roosts!"
"That's ghosts, not roasts, you silly bird."
Mark gave him a little tap with his finger. "What are ghosts doing on our beach?" Meg was annoyed.
"They mightn't be ghosts. They're probably people dressed up," said Boris. "But you'd better come and see."
"Should we get Dad?" said Mike. He wound in his line, then did the same to Meg's.
"No, we'll check it out first," said Meg,
dumping the pump on the sand and picking up her rucksack, which had the first aid kit and the mobile phone in it.
"If it looks sus, then we'll call Dad."
"We're Ghostbusters!"
yelled Mark, and Boris turned Carol round again. She loped with long camel strides back along the beach, with Boris and Mark bumping up and down on her hump, Eddie bouncing on her head, and Meg, Mike and Alice running behind.
"Ghostbusters!"
squawked Eddie at the top of his voice.
Chapter 2. See? There they are.
This time Boris didn't turn Carol, but kept charging towards the group.
Hey, you kids! Yelled one of the men. Get out of here!
It was the same person who'd shaken his fist before.
Ghosts don't yell,
puffed Meg as their little group slowed to a halt.
Well, I'll be darned, said the other man as they came nearer. A cocky riding a camel. Now I've seen everything. Cut, cut!
Roared a voice from the scrub. And suddenly the place was alive with men and women dressed in ordinary casual clothes who swarmed out from behind rocks and bushes. One man held a boom microphone. Two had cameras. Some had clipboards.
It's a movie set, said Meg in amazement. Hey, I'll bet they're making that new miniseries called Shipwreck,
breathed Mark as he slid off Carol and landed on the sand with a bump.
I saw it on TV.
You kids have just wrecked the scene,
yelled a man who came roaring out from behind a rock.
Now we've got a camel, a cocky, a fat lab and a heap of kids in the shot. Not to mention footprints everywhere. Take that moth-eaten camel and clear out.
Moth-eaten camel? Boris bristled, and so did Carol.
You don't own this beach,
Boris snapped rudely.
We can be here if we want to.
Alice growled deep in her throat. She didn't like this plump, red-faced, blustery little man who'd insulted her friend. Eddie swooped off Carol's head and flew straight at him. He ducked and dropped his clipboard.
Get lost! Over and out!
Eddie shrieked in his ear. He flapped his wings in the man's face, and the man quickly took two steps backwards, tripped on a rock and fell over.
Eddie!
Meg was horrified. She knew the cocky said rude things, but this was too much. Mark dived and picked up the man's clipboard.
Are you a real live director?
He said.
Let go of that clipboard, you little pest!
Thundered the man.
Now!
So Mark did as he was told for a change and dropped it. It fell onto some wet and slippery seaweed.
Oops, sorry,
he said, picking it up and wiping off bits of sand and slime with the sleeve of his jumper.
Why, you little...
Wait!
One of the women who was dressed in old-fashioned clothes stepped forward, removing her bonnet as she spoke. Meg gasped. It was Lisa McMahon, the famous movie and TV star. She'd won a Logie for Best Actress last year. Up close and in real life, she was even more beautiful than on TV. She had clear blue eyes, high cheekbones, smooth creamy skin and soft pink lips. Meg was in awe, being so close to someone as beautiful and famous as Lisa McMahon. Of course, Alice didn't know her from a bar of chocolate. She was always snoozing in front of the TV and didn't watch the shows. She growled. But Carol knew who she was because she usually had her nose pressed against the fly screen of the kitchen window to watch the greens eating. She also watched TV whenever she could through the lounge room window.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.